Friends, why are we now bothering about what we eat, what we do, what is the kind of food we should have? This is called reductionism. You know, man looks at things in bits and pieces each time. Let us, for a change, look at the whole. Why are we here? Where did we come from? What is our motto? And where are we going? If you look at all these things and think about it, you will come to one conclusion, which I want you to take home. It is not what you eat that keeps you going. It is what eats you that keeps you going. It is not what you eat that kills you. It is what eats you that kills you. You know what that means? Your negative thoughts. So the boss in the whole game of life is the human mind. Where is the mind? Never mind. But the mind is in, whole body is mind. In quantum physics, there is no matter, there is only energy. So you are a part of this universal energy, otherwise called universal consciousness. And you and I are so closely related, not by blood, not in family, not in race or language, but the energy that flows in you and the energy that flows in me is identical. So the first principle that we should know is this world is interconnected. Whether it is philosophy or science, it means the same thing. The world is interconnected is the philosophy of the philosophers of yore. But right from Newton's gravitational theory down to the quantum physics, the interconnectedness of this world is shown. So one doesn't have to, as a matter of fact, one of the speakers earlier said, one doesn't have to eat food to survive. Our energy mainly for survival comes from the ultraviolet rays of the sun. The sun shines on this planet and the energy is in a Schumann ring. And from the Schumann ring, each one of us gets his or her energy. As a matter of fact, there are, you know, there was a Swami I saw in Karthikeyan's house who wouldn't eat anything. He will look at the sun for about 4 hours in the morning and then he survives. He can go, he went to Manasarovar with Karthikeyan. He has got the video. And when all these people had about 10 covers of clothing, that man had just a shawl and a kachcha and he was sleeping on the snow. No shoes. He was walking barefoot on the snow in Manasarovar. And he walked up the Himalayas barefoot. And I have seen some swamis in the Tibetan monasteries. They just lie down there. If you have a Turkish towel which is wet, you put it on his chest and say, dry this. In 10 minutes, the towel will be dry because he can increase the heat of this chest so much that the whole thing gets fried. All this is possible if you know how to control your mind and how to control your energy. I'll give you a small little bit of pranayama. When you take a deep breath in and chant Om, when you say Om, this is ordinary sound. But when it goes down through your vocal cord and vibrates the vocal cord, it becomes ultrasound. You know what ultrasound is? Ultrasound travels in straight lines and ultrasound has a lot of energy. When this ultrasound goes down to what is called the alveoli, the last bit of the balloon that exchanges gas between the blood and the air, it churns the water there and produces the bubbles, small bubbles, to coalesce with each other. This is called sonoluminescence. And it produces so much of energy that you can get energy by just doing proper pranayama. If you did pranayama for 5-6 hours to 10 hours a day, you probably don't have to eat any food. Now, coming back to the mundane life that you and I lead, we need some food. But we eat much more than what we need. I always tell, in the world there are two important diseases. India, we have the largest load of subnutrition and malnutrition. We have 47 million children who don't get even a single meal. And these children suffer from a disease called NIDS, not AIDS, Nutritional Immune Deficiency Syndrome. And they die like flies. As we are discussing here about vegetarianism, a few hundred children in India have died because of malnutrition. This is malnutrition. Then in today's Western world, there is what is called malnutrition, M-A-L-L, mal, where you get all this kind of junk food. You get hot dog, white dog, and all kinds of rubbish. And then you get some poisons in the tins and bottles, colored poisons. People who drink that and eat that kind of a stuff, the hot dog, they get mal, M-A-L-L, nutrition, which is called obesity in the West. So when the West has a big epidemic of obesity, India has a large epidemic of poverty and malnutrition. There again, there are two kinds of malnutrition. If you have seen children who are malnourished, some children are bloated up, they have edema all over the body, they have a lot of water collection. Some are very thin, drying up. The drying up one called marasmus, and the thick ones are called kwashiorkor. The difference is, the child that is dried up has had some mother's milk, very little mother's milk. So it is called protein subnutrition. The child which is bloated up has had no mother's milk at all. The mother either died very soon or the mother left the child or what have you. And whatever food the child gets is not the good food, the good protein, so it damages the liver first and produces edema. Whereas the child which eats too much of the junk food becomes obese, becomes a diabetic very soon, gets heart disease and dies early. And the sad part of the whole thing is the Western epidemic of obesity is creeping into India because the West has come to India in a big way to do business here. So you can see even in a village, day before yesterday I was in a village where I saw Kentucky Fried Chicken, KFC. In a village, there's an arrow which says KFC. I really had tears in my eyes. If KFC could come to this village, in what way they have invaded? This is the biggest invasion. This is the cultural invasion. They invaded with the army in the olden days. Now they are invading with their culture. They want to sell and make money. As someone rightly said, today the world runs after money. So anything that you get from outside is not reliable because they just twist the facts to make money and sell their wares. Having said that, we can all sustain ourselves with the minimum food. That's what Ayurveda says, Hita, Mita, Ahara, Sevi. Food what you like and food in small quantities, preferably many times in a day. Minimum 6 times a day you must feed yourself with small amounts of clean, good food. And there is no way any difference between vegetarianism and non-vegetarian as far as nutrition is concerned. If anyone of you here doubts that vegetarians do not get enough strength, because a lot of youngsters are told this by the Western media, that if you don't eat meat, you can't really grow up and you can't be strong. I tell them, please come and see our temple elephants, which are pure vegetarians. If any one of those people can fight with the elephant and then win the war, I think I will become a non-vegetarian myself. Please remember that even non-vegetarians, even people who eat meat, ultimately get their protein from vegetables only. And if you don't eat much food, you will be healthier. There was a professor of biochemistry in Yale University about 20 years ago. And one of the British prime ministers of yore, who was a champion in writing on anything, had written a book called, If You Chew Every Morsel of Your Food 20 Times, You Will Be Very Healthy. So there were a few group of fanatic students in the Yale University dormitory who were chewing their food 20 times, every morsel. If you chewed food every morsel 20 times, you hardly end up eating about 10 to 15 grams of protein a day, because it takes so much time. They couldn't go to class. They had to sit there and chew and chew and chew. And he kept a watch on their health as they went through the medical school for 4 years. And the conventional eating students, at the end of 4 years, he found that these chewing students who ate very little food were much healthier, happier, and tranquil compared to the students who ate the conventional food. So the inference is, we require very little food, and all the food that you need, you get from vegetables. There are more than about 4,000 scientific papers to say that cooked meat is one of the important causes of cancer. But would you believe all these 4,000 papers are hushed up by the industry? The meat industry is so powerful that the whole thing is hushed up. You can eat meat and survive, but that meat should not be cooked. We learn our science from nature, which is called biomimicry, a new science called biomimicry. Look at all the meat-eating animals. They eat raw meat. They don't eat cooked meat. There are two meat-eating animals which we have domesticated, cat and dog. Now a dog or cat in the forest lives for 40 to 50 years. A cat or dog in your house where you give it cooked meat and cooked milk, and that lives only for 15 years to 20 years. It has halved its lifespan. So if any one of you want to be a non-vegetarian, you must eat uncooked meat in its raw state. Now look at human physiology. We were arboreous, hunter-gatherers, sleeping on the forest and sleeping on the branches or trees when we were hunter-gatherers. And we could eat only what was available there, fruits and probably some vegetables. Now very interestingly, this was the era when we were very, very healthy. Some records show that we had no illness at all. All that the causes of death were two: A, old age; B, predation. No illness. All the illnesses started in the 10,000 years when we sort of started living in communities and trying to eat not just non-vegetarian stuff, trying to eat each other. That means hating one another. Today our biggest enemy is hatred.